Welcome to the Underground, the Steel City Underground, a Pittsburgh Steelers podcast made by fans like you, for fans like you. Now, here's your host, Joe Kuzma.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to a WTF edition of the Steel City Underground podcast. My co-pilot, Terry Fletcher, is here with me, and I am your host, Joe Kuzma. Terry, we always kick this off by talking about the weather. What's going on over there in sunny California?
Well, we're headed for another rainstorm coming in this weekend, but as of today, it's nice and sunny. It's a little bit cool, but we're doing good today, so...
Okay, so the golfers, though, they don't like the rain, and we haven't had any golfing, I think, in Northeast Ohio and Western Pennsylvania since maybe October. So
well, I don't know about your golfers, but they golf here in the rain. They're out there in their full gear.
You know what, I'll retract that because my boss, he'll try and go out there no matter what, too, and you know, it's like in the 30s here, and he's probably thinking about chasing that little white ball around. But speaking of retractions, for those who don't know, Terry helps with the live tweeting, as we call it, meaning we tweet during the Steelers games as they are going on live, hence live tweet. So she has access over here besides myself to the Steel City Underground Twitter account. And what was that, Terry? Field goals are not going to win this game, huh?
Yeah, it was more of I was thinking out loud, thinking, you know what, you guys, we have got to score a touchdown. We only punted once in the game. We kept getting into the end zone, the red zone anyway, and I was just like, this, we can't keep doing this. And of course I'm eating those words now. Apparently, you know, field goals do win the game.
Yeah, six of them, in fact. So Chris Boswell, the newest killer bee, as we're all saying, I never even knew that was a playoff record, so I guess that's a WTF. And you know what? We do have a little bit of a checklist this time, a little bit of an agenda, and that's not even on it. So we're already off script, but...
well, isn't this his second game, too, with six. Didn't he do it? I think it was in Buffalo?
Well, this was a postseason. I think six. Obviously, I think somebody's... I even think Cairo Santos with the Chiefs has kicked... that might be the record. He has like seven or eight in a game, I think, last year. So for a regular season, but... But for postseason, and then also the Steelers, only team in NFL history to win a postseason game when the opponent has scored two touchdowns or more, I guess, is what the statistic was. So any other opponent that's ever scored two touchdowns in a playoff game, they win. So this has never happened. Well, let's dive into this because I'd love to talk about Chris Boswell all day, but we got some other. Well, I guess field goal's not going to win this game. We were talking about this before against the Cincinnati Bengals. I know I talked to Brian on the last episode about this, and actually your name came up too because I was talking about how I was constantly getting up and off of my couch and down on my knees and praying and everything else. I think I may have some injuries. You'll have to. And you tend to your doc. I need some of your medical advice. So I think I injured myself over this. And I want to call you Dr. Terry. I know you're not a doctor. I know it's not, but it might be your new nickname besides calling you Terry Bradshaw Fletcher.
Yeah, let's move on from that one for sure. No, I just play one on TV. That's funny.
But could you diagnose that the Pittsburgh Steelers could in fact give somebody a heart condition by the way that they play?
Yes, I would have to say, you know, in our house, the blood pressure was rising. We just, every time we kicked a field goal, first of all, in those conditions and how cold it was, and even though they kind of blew that out of proportion, but we did see some wind going, and I know Chris kept getting close to those uprights. Yeah, we were just hoping first it went through, and then sitting there going, this is just not going to do it. But, you know, he's the ever professional. I think I liked what Jordan Berry said. He said, you know, kickers can be really weird sometimes where they want the ball. And he said, just put it on the ground and I'll kick it. And thank God that's exactly what he did. So
I love that. That's such an awesome quote. And speaking of, here's another one off the script, a WTF of the weather thing blown out of proportion. I guess it was icy and whatnot. They were worried about fan safety. But as someone else had eloquently said, I may have heard this on the radio or read a tweet or something, How many games have been played at Arrowhead throughout all of the years? They're an old AFL football team. They still carry that legacy from owner Lamar Hunt, who's done many, many things throughout the league. Another one of the NFL royalty, but also AFL royalty. But how many games have been played in Kansas City in cold and poor, miserable weather, and all these people still show up? Do we think maybe as a WTF here that the NFL got it in their bright minds with the minds over at NBC, put two and two together and said, prime time playoff game. This is a good idea. This could give us more ratings. And it was. It was the highest rated wild card and or divisional playoff game in history.
I think it was. Well, they said it was, but then they gave the stats on what the Cowboys game was, and that was even higher. So I'm not really sure the ratings. They seem to be Tomlin had said with the AB video. One thing he did say, and he seemed pretty pissed about and was pretty direct about it, is the fact whoever won that game has a disadvantage as far as, yes, we know we're pumped going in to the AFC championship, but you know, you're getting home at 4 a.m. You're getting a day and a half per se less of preparation time and the travel. So regardless of the ratings, they're actually kind of giving a team a disadvantage, not just traveling back, but now we have to travel into, you know, Foxborough. So talk about giving an edge to a team who's not only been on a bye, but, you know, is the darling of the media. I just think that there's something going on there that was a little suspect to me.
Yeah, that full day and a half. And believe it or not, I actually work with a Chiefs fan, and we had considered going over there until all the ice storm things, everything like that. And you had said in our off the air, one of our little private chats that we have, okay, I know you guys are crazy. Are any of you going to Kansas City? And it was like, it was considered. And, you know, a good friend of mine, and he was cool with the game and everything. He pretty much said that that's the way. He said, we aren't going to be able to stop Le'Veon Bell. And he knows how Andy Reid is. And despite his Chiefs doing better than they had in previous years, he kind of expected the outcome the way that it happened. And when we're talking, I just lost my train of thought. Go figure. Game and a half, referring to, we're going to get to this AB video. I have it for the end. We may be talking about it before, but it was Mike Tomlin saying, okay, guys, preparation starts now. And this is in the locker room after the game. The preparation starts now because those a-holes, and I could say the full word, and I guess some people were shocked by that language, even though it's said on network TV and PG movies, no less. I mean, the only thing that makes a rated R movie with language is if you drop the F-bomb, and I guess you have to say it more than once. It could even be said in a PG-13, something like that. I know these things because, I've mentioned many times on the show to our listeners, I officiate another sport, and sometimes people get on me about language, and I'm dealing with adults, collegiate athletes, and some of the words that are said, and I look and I say, hey coach, you know what, this is no worse than what's heard in music or on TV. So the people got outraged and shocked by this, he said the word a-hole, you know what I mean? Oh, come on, grow up. I mean, geez, you know what, my three-year-old may have said it already. It doesn't make it right necessarily, but come on, don't be shocked by that language. But he says they've got a day and a half preparation, advanced preparation, and I totally agree with that. Now, I don't have a problem with the first seeds playing on Saturday. I don't have a problem with the four-game lineup. It is that disparity of moving that game from 1 to 8 o'clock, pushing them back seven hours or so for that kickoff, 7.5 hours almost, and then they arrive at 4 a.m. On their plane after the game. I mean, that is a taxing day, day or 2 days of travel. They probably had to make preparations. What if there was weather? It would have delayed them even more, and that kind of sucks. It sucks for the Steelers. They're not going to make any excuses about it. Tomlin's not going to make any excuses about it. But we know one guy that had plenty of excuses in this Kansas City game, and that was Travis Kelce, who had a fantastic meltdown.
Yeah, he did it. You know, I haven't seen his reality show, Chasing Kelce. I've heard about it because apparently once a girl goes out with him, he can't get her to date him twice. And so I can see that. I mean, Justin Houston was in his face about, you know, the push he had on, I think it was Cockrell, and just losing his emotions. I mean, talk about, you know, I think I mentioned it in my article, the Odell AFC version, but, you know, the stage was too big for him. Wasn't this his first playoff game? And, you know, to sit there and say that somebody felt sorry for James Harrison, first of all, that's funny. Nobody feels sorry for James Harrison, you know, and you know, it's just funny to me that his comments were so, I don't know. They were just so childish and you know, sour grapes and talk about a guy that had a terrible game. I mean, he had two passes that he caught that were fine, but in key moments, he blew it. He absolutely blew it.
Yeah, he had two drops in this game, 5 for 77. He had one. He probably had one play that was a major impact, maybe two, off the top of my head. But if you're not familiar with what we're referring to, Travis Kelce, aside from the penalty that happened in the game, post game he went out. Well, he didn't go anywhere. He was in his locker room. They approached him in front of his locker, and whatever reporter or reporters asked him questions, he just goes on this tirade about officiating, and this is a direct quote. He says, "Momentum was getting on our side, and then just get our jugulars ripped out because a ref felt bad for James Harrison falling on the ground. It's ignorance. Ref number 51 shouldn't even be able to wear a zebra jersey ever again. He shouldn't even be able to wear it at an effing Foot Locker." And as you said, you feel bad for comparing the Foot Locker employees because they do work hard. But, you know, while I chuckled at that, this was probably the most obvious holding call in the history of holding calls. We never see James Harrison draw this call despite probably getting held on every single play. He dips on Eric Fisher. His feet are past him. Fisher does not disengage from the block. He has him in a chokehold, nearly kind of clothesline him if he didn't have a hold of him. And, you know, takes it, he didn't just fall. If you want just fall, Ramon Foster said it on his show on Tuesday morning. We're talking about the Patriots game from week 7 when Jamie Collins fell in front of Chris Hubbard, who was playing at right tackle in place of Marcus Gilbert, and it nullified a Landry Jones, the Darius Hayward Bay touchdown that would have been very significant in that game, and it was taken off the board. I think, and in fact, the big ragu, Ramon Foster says, addressing Kelce's comments, you know, you should take a look at that play and then tell me if you think one is different from the other when it comes to calls. But we're not making it. And once again, the Steelers not making any excuses for anything there. I thought that was a nice little jab back at Kelce. But geez, man, I mean, you have a game what? Like you do. You blow up and then you blow up on the officials afterwards because the officials lost the game for you, right?
Well, I think the thing, too, is that and, you know, the media never really cuts any slack to the Steelers. I think, I don't know if it's professional jealousy with the fact that we've got six Lombardis and nobody else does, but you know, they're always quick to criticize. I've noticed. And they actually were pretty interesting. They're like, dude, that was a penalty. You know, look at it. He has him around the neck. But what's interesting, and I can't find the clip because I saw it once, but it was something that was Deion Sanders. They had it on NFL Network right after the game. And Eric Fisher, as disappointed as he was, he said, yeah, he goes, there was no way he was going to get to Alex, and I just needed to let him go and push instead of pull. And so he even said, yeah, I did it. So, you know, it just seemed like he just had this meltdown Travis Kelce meeting, and he didn't do any service to his team by doing that. I mean, you know, the only thing I think is good as far as that whole thing, well, obviously we won the game, but you know what? Now, Alex Smith, who had a great game, by the way, he's going to the Pro Bowl. So he replaced the Raiders quarterback, Derek Carr. So that's good.
Yeah, I think, and this is going to be in a film room. I was actually working on it right before we went on air here. The defensive film room, filling in for Josh this week once again. He's dealing with being the new daddy and everything. So we have a few clips of just pressure. Kansas City fans just went on an incredible tirade about how Alex Smith missed the wide open Tyreek Hill, and even Chris Collinsworth gushed about it. And I think it's a little false. You have to see what James Harrison was doing in that game. He had the only sack. You'll see some of this on the film, too, so I don't want to beat a dead horse here. But Harrison, these guys were getting pressure. Dupree, they're getting pressure. They only brought down Smith just once. He had a solid game, but there is no way he was going to reach Tyreek Hill. At the point of when that happened, too, he probably appeared as though he was covered. He had James Harrison breathing down his neck. And because these series of events happened throughout the game, it led to James having drawn that penalty, which is just as big of a play as if he would have even gotten to Smith. So kudos to James Harrison for that. And also, blaming the referees. Travis Kelce should really go on social media and blame the guy who stepped on the terrible towel and gave a middle finger to it, because the Myron Cope curse, it's real. As you said, Terry, we need to ship some towels up to Boston. Let those New England Patriots fans do what you want with them. Wipe your butt with it or something. Just make sure you post it on social media and doom your team for next Sunday.
Well, you know, and Bill Belichick, you know, when he was kind of joking around about when they asked him about AB's video, which we'll get to in a minute, and he said, you know, I don't follow face chat and I don't do that. Somebody had asked him about a terrible towel and something to the effect, he just smiled and said, well, let's hope they don't do that. And he kind of rolled his eyes. It was just funny. So he gets it. He's like, yeah, let's just not even go there. But it was just funny. He just kind of smiled. And you don't get a smile out of him very often, but he knew exactly what people were talking about.
No, he's stone-faced. I have a feeling he knows what he's talking about with Snapchat and Facebook. He said, like, InstaChat and Snapface. And I think he's saying it just to – he's not a media guy, and I think he's saying it to be silly. In the same regard, Ben Roethlisberger said something very similar to that as well. They asked him about AB, and yeah, we'll get to AB in a second. So these guys have the long flight, right? And they get in at 4 a.m., and of course, what's the first thing that these guys do on Monday, which is, you know, these guys really don't have a day off, especially this part of the season. They're probably still reviewing film and whatnot, but for all intents and purposes, they're not practicing. This is kind of their day off, even though they arrive early in the morning back in Pittsburgh. James Harrison goes straight to the weight room and starts banging some iron. The guy is crazy. He's a beast. I don't know. And he's 38. And, you know, I'm starting to get up there in years, too. And I'm nowhere near the athlete James Harrison is. Probably not even like 1% of the athlete he is. The guy's absolutely just he's a monster. And on the same token, you have Kobe Hamilton. And it was like Arizona Farm Bureau, I think, or something like that, that had caught him on Instagram. And they had a picture of him holding a calf. And it says, we love him because he loves calves, or he loves them, so we love him, yeah. with the hashtag. And he actually, like, retweeted or responded to it and says, I was already at the sales barn right off the plane or something like that. And I'm like, I didn't even know the guy was into agriculture or farming or whatever. So you have Harrison going to weight room, and Kobe Hamilton's going to an early morning farm auction. Like, what is going on with these guys? It's crazy what they do on their days off.
Well, you know, they either got some sleep on the plane, or a general is just there and they just realized that, you know what, we're the elite four. We're one of the four, and we're getting back soon, and I can totally see that taking over. So that, I mean, it just, but James is just, he's gone viral. His agent actually put something out that said that everybody always comes to me and says, how can I get the James Harrison way to do things? I want to be put on, or his trainer, I guess, put on his program and everything. He said, okay, well, I can give it all to you, but it's the will to do it. You have to have the mentality to do it, and I can't bottle that. And so, you know, that's he's just a different person altogether, and Mike Tomlin says it all the time. But his presence, I mean, just WTF the last 9 games in a row. I mean, he just, between him and our rookies and just how it came together, as soon as he got back on the field as a starter, our season turned around, and thank God we have him.
Yeah, me and Brian talked about how they probably saved him and stuff like that too. But the exact, it was at Arizona Beef, the Arizona Beef Council. It's hashtag he loves cattle, so we love him.
And we love him. Yeah, I saw that.
Got in at 4 this morning, leaving the sale barn now. And he messaged that at like 2:30 in the afternoon. So he got a little bit of sleep and then went. So he probably didn't go. I don't know. Those things are usually like at 6 or at least 8 in the morning from my understanding of dealing with county fairs and whatnot. So that's pretty crazy. That's some good feel-good stuff on social media and coming from Arizona Beef. But we also had some really bad trolls out there on the internet. We happen to know and have contact with many people who help with social media aside from some of the players direct themselves. We have the privilege of doing that here at Steel City Underground and just seeing some of the threats. When I saw those, Terry, and you shared some of those with me, I'm just thinking it has to be a troll account. I don't even know that we want to repeat some of the ugly things that were said, but I mean, it was borderline like psychopathic type. Why would somebody message we'll throw a name out there. We'll say Ben Roethlisberger, for example, and like threaten. I don't know that I would necessarily even want to say some of the words. Like I'll say even up to like murder, wishing death upon people.
Yeah, I just think it's disgusting. I mean, just you know, it's a game. Football's a game, and when things don't go your way, to threaten people's families and. I mean, I even, you know, when we had that thing last year with Perfect and what he did to AB, somebody actually said something really derogatory about his kids. And I can't stand that player. I don't think he needs to be in the league, but I would never condone anybody saying anything derogatory about his young children. And this is what happened over the weekend, you know, yesterday and Sunday. And just, you know, hearing and seeing some of the text and, you know, we reported it. You know, we report those people. You have an opportunity to have a, you know, how far are we going to let things go? And that basically, I thought that was stepping over the cliff. That was just basically at a point where you can't tolerate that kind of threatening, you know, and just disparaging comments. It's more than just being offended. It's, you know, it's safety. It's just so inappropriate and it's just wrong.
It's amazing the keyboard muscles some of the people get. And I think some of these people, it's even worse. Like I understand you're going to create an account and just go after somebody and you think you're being cute and maybe you yuck it up with a few of your friends. Haha, see what I said this to like Antonio Brown or whatever it might be. And it's just like, on the other hand, you have people that have legitimate like Facebook and Twitter accounts that attach their name to things in public. It's mind blowing what I see out there. And to the point of, and you pointed this out to me, I think I heard it, but I didn't actually remember it, was there were Chiefs fans that were threatening Eric Fisher, but it wasn't the same Eric Fisher that was on the football field. This guy's a meteorologist. He's like a local news guy. He's the weatherman. And,
right.
And they're threatening him on Twitter because all of these guys have public profiles with the local TV stations, which, by the way, shout out to KDK Channel 2 out of Pittsburgh for sharing the ESPN graphic that we put out there. If you didn't see it, and many people did, all the ESPN talking heads picked the Chiefs to win the game. The Chunky Soup fan pick, Campbell's Chunky Soup fan pick, and I think I mentioned this the other day, they picked the Steelers, so they're the only ones who got it right. But threatening Eric Fisher, not the right Eric Fisher, definitely a WTF, so much as America's team.
Yeah, I'm kind of over the whole, you know,
22 years.
Cowboys, really? Yeah, it was the last time. I mean, my daughter's gonna be 22 next month, and the last time they've won a champion, you know, a divisional, you know, championship or even getting in close, it was when she was born. So, I mean, do the math. It's, you know, Steelers are everywhere. They're, you know, they are nation worldwide. We see so many military people with terrible towels and I'm in California and we can't walk into a grocery store or anywhere without seeing somebody with a Steeler hat, a Steeler shirt. You know, we could vacation in Hawaii. I mean, it's big over there. So, you know, America's team, yeah, give me a break. You know, it's Steelers. It's definitely not the Cowboys.
Yeah, and in fact, there was something like the time, I think it was the timeline, and they were talking about coining this phrase, and somebody quizzed me with it too, and they were saying, I guess the Steelers may have been offered that first. And when the Cowboys were offered that tagline, that even legendary coach Tom Landry hated it because he said, why do you want to give the opponent more ammunition? Which is segueing very nicely into our last feature here. We have to address the Antonio Brown going on Facebook Live whole situation. Everybody's been asked it. Ramon Foster was asked it on his show. Ben Roethlisberger was asked it. Mike Tomlin had some pretty choice words about AB as well. I guess, in fact, we even had an article about it. Brian wrote about it extensively. I guess we all sum it up with, it's not so much, we talked about like the language and some of the things that Tomlin said. It's not so much what was said or done or seeing in the locker room. I guess it was, you're more disappointed because it's more of a private moment more than anything. And you're breaking some trust by, you're kind of running this on the sneak instead of, hey, letting some of your teammates know that you're going to go on live and kind of including them in on it. At the same time, the irony and the WTF being Mike Tomlin saying, you know, watch what you're doing on social media, pretty much stay off of social media. We don't want to give them any more ammo. And here you go. There's the ammo.
Right. Right. And, you know, and I think the thing that really, and I could, oh man, on the Tomlin Tuesday, you know, cast that they put on Periscope, which is so nice that Steelers do that, you know, where we get to see him live and hear him live. He addressed it to begin with, and he's hot. He's pretty mad about it. And for him to have to apologize for, you know, I thought they were pretty tame comments. So I'm sure it's been terrible. I mean, the comments that I'm sure comes out of the Patriots locker room are 20 times worse. But, you know, just to apologize for something he said in a private context, you know, because he says, you know, I'm a father and I know that this is, you know, role models. It was just so sad to just have to see that. But then I think the key is what he said as far as he really commented on how talented AB is, what a work ethic he has, and he's respected for that. But it's also about being a good teammate. And he didn't go on to say he wasn't a good teammate, but basically he said, you know, this is a universal thing that we find these talented players who are going from team to team to team because they miss that aspect, and we hope he learns from it. And in a contract year where they're saying he could be the highest paid wide receiver, you know, WTF, AB, what the heck are you doing out there? You know, that is just so me, very selfish thing for him to do. And, you know, he follows me on social media, so I may be overstepping. I may get an unfollow here for that. So, you know, but you have to keep it real. And hopefully he scaled it back and realized, you know, that was wrong. And you know, and Coach Tomlin participates some times when he knows the video's going on. He'll stop by and photobomb or put a, you know, peace sign and say something. So when he does the what it is thing he does within the locker room, that's again approved. That's fine. But it's the secrecy and to let that audio be on there and then not even to listen to his post-game words. It just the whole situation was bad.
Yeah, it seemed a little disrespectful is probably the best word. And
it is,
Tomlin himself had said it was foolish of him to do that, selfish and inconsiderate. It was a violation of our policy and league policy. He had also mentioned that he will punish Antonio Brown internally. There may be consequences from the NFL, but he hasn't yet seen him or talked to him. He also mentions he's a great player, respected largely in the locker room, but incidents such as this don't help him. It's often why you see great players move from team to team, and you don't want to see that happen with Antonio Brown. And of course, last week was the boot on Ben's foot, the walking boot, and how it was blown out of proportion. We're surprised that people didn't say that he had his leg amputated. The WTF this week coming from this is ESPN spinning those comments about this is why you see great players go team from team to team. I mean, examples right there. There's a number of them. There's Terrell Owens. There's that may even keep Terrell Owens out of the Hall of Fame if people thinking about things off the field type situations there. Chad Ochocinco and many, many, many others that have been head case. Jeff George, quarterback, for example, who was a hothead. So this is what ESPN puts out, and you saw me send this to you guys offline here. It's a Steelers video. Antonio Brown's future in Pittsburgh not guaranteed, according to Jim Trotter and Dan Graziano. Are you kidding me?
I saw that as an alert. Did they really say that?
Yeah, you know what? I didn't even give them. You know, this is bad because I'm reading the headline, and a lot of times I was just having this conversation about, you know, journalistic integrity and how everything has a clickbait headline. If that's not any more clickbait and spinning someone's words into something else, I don't know what is. This guy has an opportunity. He's already holds, I don't know how many made up NFL records and others, such as the most catches within a 4-year span, or he's second to Marvin Harrison or something in that regard. He's had two of the highest receptions totals in NFL history. I think he has like the second most and the fourth most. I think Julio Jones is in there somewhere. And, of course, Marvin Harrison holds that mark as well, enjoying all those years with Peyton Manning. This isn't a guy that you're just like, you know, he's not out there smoking dope. He's not getting suspended. He's not getting in fights with teammates or punching the kicker's net or anything of that nature. He's not part of, like, ball bats on the field and boat trips. And most of these all point to another diva wide receiver, by the way. And I don't intentionally mean to just throw a bunch of shade at Odell Beckham. He has to grow up some, too. He's much younger than Antonio Brown. Antonio Brown's 28. By that point, I'm already getting married. The maturity has to kick in at some point. I think Antonio Brown just does this to have fun. He probably didn't mean any harmful intentions by doing this,
no.
But it also shows a little bit of immaturity of knowing that the locker room is a sacred place. The things that the coaches and teammates are saying and doing there are meant or thought to have been private. Those aren't things that they probably want publicly aired, even if what Mike Tomlin says is in fact true and just the choice words or whatever he uses. Let me tell you this. You guys don't hear me outside of this podcast. Some of the words, I am the son of a trucker, so some of the words I use aren't the best words, and I even say some of them around my daughter when I probably shouldn't. And when you think about it in hindsight and even thinking about it now, gee, maybe I shouldn't say that. It's probably the way Antonio Brown feels about it right now. Much ado about nothing. Probably will apologize if he hasn't already, and it will all be water under the bridge, much like the Joey Porter incident that happened that we've already forgotten about. We're riding a high into the AFC Championship. Let's move on. No more distractions.
Right. I agree with that. I think it's just going to be, he's going to probably get fined about $25,000 within the organization. You know, he respects the Rooney family, and I think that he just made a bad judgment call, kind of like all those penalties he got for celebrations. It was very entertaining. We loved it, just like we love how he engages with fans, but we didn't need the penalties. If you want to get fined, that's on you, but the 15 yards was killing our special teams. So, you know, Kobe Hamilton was babysitting him for a while, and I think this is along those lines where he just needs to just kind of get some maturity, dude, and just realize what is okay, what isn't okay, what's about you, what's about team, and be a good teammate. And I think he will. I think all that Tomlin will have to do is have a meeting with him and look at him, and that's it. He basically is going to say, you know what, you're grounded, and that, you know, basically just send him to his room for a bit. But I think there's so much respect there, and I know how much Coach loves him as a son, you know, I think, and I just think that he's like, what are you doing? Knock it off.
Yeah.
And I think that'll be the end of it. He'll get a financial penalty, I think, on both from the league and from that, but I think then we'll move on from it, and hopefully he's learned from it. But just one more thing I wanted to add just to about AB, but about not about the video. I don't know if you saw the clip, but right after the game in Kansas City, huge WTF moment. I guess he was talking some trash on the field, and Coach and Joey Porter had to kind of break it up and move him away. Did you see that?
There was a little bit of that. Cameras don't always catch that. I think I saw some of it posted.
Yeah, I
after
saw some
fact.
Of it.
So, you know, it's like one of those things, I try and live by a philosophy sometimes. Now, I could be very blunt, I could be critical, but I try to be professional in my dealings, especially here with Steel City Underground. If you don't have something nice to say, don't say it at all. Just head to the locker room. I mean,
exactly. And I didn't realize he was such a trash talker. I heard that he can give it just as well as he can take it on the field, because I think it's a size issue. He just tries to, you know, be bigger than he is. But
yeah,
I find it kind of funny.
And who's not to say he wasn't provoked too? Usually you catch
you usually catch
the retaliator in almost every single instance of anything that happens, with the exception of Kelsey, because he shoved Cockrell on his butt pretty good in plain view of everyone. But we were talking about how many killer bees can we add to this? Can we add like Jordan Berry, for example? And I said maybe some guys like Jarvis Jones changed his name to Jarvis Bones so he could be a bee. But how about Kobe? Kobe could
there
be another
you go.
One.
There you go. Well, and Butler needs to be added, and now we do have Boswell. I think it's definitely expanding itself because of just how impressive all these guys are playing as a team.
Yeah, they need Kobe to take AB to the farm auction. Just babysit him all the time. So then AB's like the little brother hanging around with, he may actually be older than Kobe Hamilton, I'm not sure, but he's going to have to hang around with Kobe attached to his hip and go everywhere. He's handcuffed to him. So that would be kind of funny to see. But hey, Terry, we're up against it as usual. Always fun having you on. Thanks for taking your time today to say WTF.
You bet. That was great.
And fans, once again, you know what? We'd like to hear from you. And we're going to have some downtime next week because regardless of what happens, there'll be a week. There'll be the Pro Bowl, but who cares about that? So we go from the conference championships to a week off 2 weeks before the Super Bowl. So we'll want to hear from you, too. So dial us up. That's 203-900, the number 4, SCU. We want to hear what you think. Until next time, be safe, be good, and we will catch you later. We'll be right back.
We would like to thank you for listening and remind our listeners to follow us on social media and our website, www.steelcityunderground.com.